Hello viewers, this is Samuel Olumuyiwa Ali and welcome to Afroscandic Guest Spot. It's my pleasure to welcome the president, the former president of Madagascar, Mr. Marc Ravalomanana.
Yes.
Welcome, sir, to Afroscandic.
Thank you.
Has been your your journey all the way from Madagascar to Copenhagen? Have you been enjoying your stay?
Yes, of course. I enjoyed it. It's like my second house because I've been here many times.
Oh.
I know life here and in Copenhagen. And our partner is from Sweden and from Denmark.
Okay.
So I know it. And I enjoy to come here.
Oh.
It was very good.
Okay. You're welcome.
Now,
straight to some of the questions our viewers will be wondering to know from you. Could you please share with us a little about the experience after the coup in Madagascar?
It's so hard. Because after the coup in 2009, life in Madagascar was terrible. The Madagascar people have suffered too much. You know, in Africa, the politics in Africa is not the same like here in European. So after the coup, the victims of this coup, of course it's just me, the president at the time, but the Malagas people have suffered. 22 million Malagas people have suffered about this coup, after the coup. Why? Because all the international community suspend all the aid, the assistance, and the they don't accept the illegal regime at this time. 3 years ago, in 2013, the new president was elected, but it's not solved again the coup. And it's not solved again the crisis in Madagascar. We still have a crisis in Madagascar. The life is so hard. The people are so deep in the poverty. So it's not so easy to restart again the life in Madagascar. And not only in Madagascar, but in SADC country, because Madagascar is member of SADC. So hopefully we understand how can we rebuild again the confidence with the international community. Because they don't trust us. They don't trust Madagascar. So the thing we have to explain to the world now, it is a new life, it is a new program. But I'm here to help the lady. She does a very, very good film in this documentary film.
Yeah,
and I'm sure we too in Madagascar, in Africa, we have to learn about this crisis. Because the past is past, of course, but we can take some lesson from this.
That's true, that's true. So if I might know, what is the role of France in this crisis?
I cannot say about the role of France, but of course Madagascar is the, one of the country colonized by France, and the mentality, the culture was close to the France. But France is France, and at this time it's different than now. In 2009, the policy of France in Madagascar is completely different than now, because our relationship is great and it's good right now.
If I understand you, so you mean the economy situation in Madagascar right now is not as it were when you were the president?
70% of Madagascar people are living under $100 per day. That means this is so poor, the poorest country in the world. So if you ask me about the economic situation in Madagascar, in 2008, our economic growth, we're too far, 7.8%, and now I don't know if it is 2% or 3%.
That's true. So that's why you will be willing to contest in the next election in 2018.
It is my challenge, and it is my goal to support the Malagasy people and to restart again a new Madagascar and to work together for Malagasy people. I got a lot of experiences in South Africa during my staying there, 6 years. And I can share with the Malagasy people my expertise from South Africa, from Africa. And I now understand how can we develop Madagascar. The potential in Madagascar is so huge. Our natural resources and our Malagasy people are friendly. We can work and we can develop it. So that is my challenge to reach again our target to lift up the lifestyle in Madagascar.
That's good. So you're hoping you're going to win in the election, or what's your...
My hope is so huge. That's why I'm going to run again to contest this presidential election. I'm sure the majority of Malagasy people are supporting me, and then the international community. I met some people abroad Madagascar, and I understand what they want to say.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
That's good. But of course, you're optimistic you're going to win, then you might also have some challenges. What are the challenges in this preparation towards the election?
You see, I cannot say to you straight what is these challenges, but everybody, if they want to run the contesting election, everybody wants to mm-hmm. win. We have the hope to get the result, mm-hmm. positive result. So I cannot say it, but we will see. That depends on the international community, because the European Union and Denmark is member of the European Union.
Yeah, sure.
The election should be free and fair, and the result is credible. That is the key to solve the crisis in Madagascar, and that is the way we can get some good result and solve the crisis in Madagascar. If not, if we will rig the election, uh-huh. and if we will do it in their own philosophy, it's not good.
Oh,
because the policy in African country, uh-huh. sometimes the corruption is so high. Every level of institution, corruption is too high.
That's
so hopefully the election will be credible,
uh-huh.
and the Malagasy people are, can choose
right.
the leader they want to lead them.
So I hope the incumbent government, the president, is giving you the freedom to do everything.
And now it's not.
Okay.
Because even for the freedom of speech or the expression of the... It's not until now.
Okay.
But we have to fight on this.
Okay. And it's known to the international community.
That's why I say to you, SADC is play a role so important in Madagascar. And Madagascar must respect the protocol.
Uh-huh.
That means this election will be free and fair. And then the international community, like in European Union,
uh-huh.
the African Union,
uh-huh.
and the UNDP,
yeah.
yeah, because UNDP is the leader. They should lead the election in Madagascar.
Yeah. Oh, that's interesting. That's great. So are you also reaching out to other Madagascans outside the country, those who are in Europe or other parts of the world? Do you also reach out to them for this preparation of the election?
For Madagascar, the Malagasy people outside of Madagascar cannot allow to vote.
Okay.
But of course, the influence from the in Madagascar is important. So I want to listen to them and to discuss with them.
Uh-huh.
Because they live here in a developed country.
Yeah.
We can know what we want to do in Madagascar, in our country.
Uh-huh. It's very important, because also actually the Danish, they heard about Madagascar for the first time during the coup in 2009,
mm-hmm.
So many people do not know the country, but through the coup they know. So now that the election is about to happen again, I think it's a good avenue to tell, to let people know also about your aim of coming back to the presidency.
Yeah, what is the reason? Sometimes even you have to make it in positive,
mm-hmm.
even if it is negative in your life. And if on the sake of the interest of Madagascar, I prefer and I want to show to the people how can we do this election, to prepare this election very well and to show to the world Malagas people can are very, very mature and you can make it, election free and fair. But the problem is this corruption and then the intimidation and then for the respect the rule of law and the human right. So many things in Madagascar I can explain to you if we have time about this human right, because we don't respect the human right in Madagascar. The ranking of Madagascar is very, very low right now. But this human right, we don't respect the human being in Madagascar, we don't respect the democracy, the freedom of speech, and the intimidation is so high.
That's great. So how many parties do you have, I mean, that is contesting for this election right now?
If you ask me about how many parties, it's 113
wow.
parties in Madagascar. That means it's not so...
Oh, no.
Yes, 113 parties, political parties in Madagascar. It's not serious. That's why we have to make it in the right way and the right time. And then to make it very, very open, to explain to the people, it's not necessary to have so many political parties. After the coup, the society in Madagascar is divided. And it's very, very hard to
bring
restore
it
again, to bring it one focus.
Uh-huh.
That means to develop our country. To develop economically in Madagascar, it's not a problem. Because we have huge resources, but to rebuild again the confidence or the trust in our family, it's very hard.
Thank you. Now I have two questions. Now people will be wondering, now what do you want to do that the present government is not doing? Why do you really want to, what will you do better than the present government if you win?
After the coup, I realized that there was some problem in our country because they promised a lot and they made a propaganda to outside me, to have me in the power. And me too, I learned a lot, as I said to you, in South Africa. I didn't stop to understand how can we resolve the political conflict. Because every time with you and everywhere in the African country, where is the conflict
uh-huh.
come from?
Uh-huh.
This is the exclusivity.
Yeah.
They exclude them or they don't ask them to participate. So inclusivity is so important.
Yeah.
And to listen to them, to the people. So that is very important for me to open this area to discuss and to fix the vision, to have a vision and to make again Madagascar action plan, to work together. Coming together is the beginning, but working together is the result. And we are not afraid to do that. Because it's easy for me to tell them, look, during our time in 2001 until 2008, we developed our country and reached the goal with the economic growth 7.8%. And then we build the road, the infrastructure is developed, and our children is going to school. They are going to school, and the health, everything.
It's functioning.
Yeah, it was very, very nice at this time. And we work closely with the international community, the IMF,
World Bank, yeah.
And the European Union. So that means we can tell them and they will respect it.
And you have an open economy too, Mr. President.
Yes.
The economy to everybody.
Yeah, the economy too. Okay. Because the problem right now in Madagascar, we have suffered, as I said to you, but the economy, we have to create as a businessman. I was a businessman and I'm still. But we can create a new environment for the businessman to come to Madagascar, and this can bring the economy to raise it again.
Thank you so much.
Yeah,
now the last question, do you have any special message for now you visited Denmark and you're in Copenhagen, and if you have a special message for the people of Denmark?
Yes, I'm here in Denmark. I feel like at home, and I'd like to congratulate the filmmaker, Lotte, and the family. They work together. But I didn't realize we'll have this film, documentary film like this, because during this time when they recorded, I was very, very stressed, and during the reconciliation, not a reconciliation, but the political accord in Maputo, in Botswana, in Addis Ababa, it was very, very hard. But Lotte, she was with us all the time. So I want to tell the Danish people, thank you so much to receive them for your hospitality and to the participation you do because this is good for the people who don't understand Madagascar, who don't know Madagascar. It's so important to see this film, the documentary film. It is real. It was me during this film, and it's not so easy at this time. It's not, because when they stopped me to go back at home, what is the film? The title of this film is Return of a President, because they banned me to return to my country, and then they didn't expect the roadmap. So I'm very, very happy to be here and to meet again my friend and to visit Denmark. Yesterday we went to Aarhus to meet some friends there, because as I say to you, I've been here many times.
Wow, that's good. Thank you. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
So we look forward to see you more in Copenhagen, Denmark.
Okay.
Thank you for your time, Mr.
Yeah,
President. Thank you. Also in the team of Mr. Marc Ravalomanana is Mr. Peter that would like to speak with us. Welcome, Mr. Peter.
Thank you.
How's been the journey and also the Copenhagen Ducks that you are participating? Can you tell us?
Yeah, I think I would like to share the President's opinion and say thank you to the filmmakers for making what is a very intimate portrait of what actually happened. And as the President says, it's his life. It's not a fantasy movie.
Yeah.
It's a documentary about what really happened. And I think that I think it's a marvelous film of a very difficult time for the President, and I think it was a very difficult time for the country. And I think that if I had one message that I would like to share with you, it's to say that I think the international community needs to realize that the crisis in Madagascar is not over. It wasn't solved by the end of the negotiation was a was a so-called ni-ni option, where they said that neither the president nor the coup leader could stand for re-election. Okay, and I think it's quite easy then for the world to think that the crisis is now resolved because there's another president, and I think the other problem is that Madagascar, which is, you know, the fourth largest island in the world, but it's an island, so it has no neighbors. So what happens in Madagascar doesn't spill over and impact as things do in the rest of the world. So it's easy for the world to think that Madagascar is solved, and to think that the best thing is that, you know, there's a new president and we move on from the coup and all the rest of it. Okay, that is just not true.
But don't you have a journalist in or media in Madagascar that will be able to, even if it is isolated and is located in an island that is not...
Sure. The media in Madagascar, like the rest of the society. So you have to realize that Madagascar is not a Western democracy in the sense that you're living in Denmark or even in South Africa, where I live. There's a robust media and there's a questioning media. None of that really exists in Madagascar. The media is very polarized. It's owned by different people. It's pushing a political line depending on whose media it is. So let me tell you one story from the time of the coup. Was that there was a person doing a radio interview in a television studio, and the coup leader listened to what he was saying and didn't agree with it. So they sent their troops in, they arrested the guy, destroyed him, and destroyed the studio. So it's not a normal society.
Thank you, Mr. Peter. It's nice being here with us today. Thank you so much.
Okay.